I'm going to post it as is, okay? Recording has started. I'm not going to edit anything.
Okay. हाँ हाँ, मत edit कर.
Good evening, Asha.
Good evening.
Yeah, Ansi today. Who is from Kollam?
Okay, from Kerala.
Ansi, say hello to Asha.
Hi, Ashalata.
Hi. Hi, Ansi.
Asha has been a state level basketball player for Kerala.
Oh my gosh! My God!
Wow!
Amazing.
I used to play basketball in my school time.
Yeah. I used to just love the game. And loving it so much, I got into state. That's all. It wasn't a...
That's lovely.
Those days, it was an uphill struggle to play, you know. Parents were all not that supportive. They always said, no, go and study. No, games were something. Even nowadays, there's so much support, you know. And I myself supported my children so much when they wanted to play.
We are aware parents. We are great actually.
You know what? I think we are the sorry generation.
Why do you think that?
Why? Because we had to say sorry to our parents and we have to say sorry to our children also.
Jaya, you'll have to get an S on your jersey now.
I don't say sorry now, but what to do?
No, your X, Y, Z, you'll have to add S also there. Good evening, Deepak.
At some level, we should stop.
Good evening, Prem Raj. Good evening, everyone.
Good evening. Good evening, Doctor.
Good evening, Doctor.
Okay, people are joining in. Yeah. We'll wait for 2-3 minutes.
Yeah.
We should call this program Evenings with Prem Raj.
Chai pe charcha, Prem Raj. Chai pe charcha.
7 baje ka chai. Coffee with Karan ke baad spices with Prem Raj.
Coffee with Prem Raj. That's me on my cup.
On Sunday around this time, around 6:37, I was attending a Rotary ka program at district level. And they had named it appropriately Roast and Toast.
Wow.
Kumar, they're going to toast after roasting.
The toast was in the glass. And the roasting, they had two people competing against each other. It was a friendly match.
Okay.
Friendly verbal match.
Okay.
And then at the end of it, they actually raised a toast to everyone.
Very nice. Let me know when you think we should start at 7 o'clock. If you want to wait for a minute or two, we can. And then we can start. Whatever.
Good evening, Arvind.
Anisha, we can keep putting a spotlight on whoever is speaking.
Power off.
Yeah. Okay, I think we'll start then so that we don't get late. As and when I introduce and as and when Prem Raj sir introduces, I think people will join in by then, Max, right?
Yeah.
So it's 7-2 and we start. Yes, Ansi, good for you.
Yeah.
Okay. So good evening and a very warm welcome once again to Power Up's speaker series with Prem Raj. I mean, this series is popular. It's gaining so much traction. People are looking forward to attend this. And there is so much learning, so much synergy. And each speaker that Prem Raj sir is bringing on this platform is giving so much value, so much learning, so much inspiration that you cannot tell. So thank you, each one of you, for being here today. I welcome each and every one of you to Power Up platform to be with us here today with Prem Raj and Ansi today to hear a beautiful conversation which is going to inspire us yet again. Power Up is a platform. It's a business platform for people, for entrepreneurs who are looking at growing together. We come here together, collaborate, co-create, generate a lot of synergy. This is one place where I have seen that each member is rooting for the other one's success. Each member is looking out for the other. Each member is wanting to bring more value to the group. And that's the only reason why Power Up is succeeding and increasing time and again, only and only because of its members. So if you think that you want to be a part of a group which can bring you value, which can bring you business, which can bring you money, which can bring you energy, which can bring you motivation and so much more, be a part with us. And we will put in all the details on the chat and you can connect with us later. For now, we are looking forward for this session, which I couldn't wait for, because two of my favorite people are going to create some great learnings. Let me introduce to you K.V. Prem Raj. He is an author and futurist speaker on leadership and management. K.V. Prem Raj has spent 37 years in banking with experience in public and private sector. He was also the CEO of the BPO arm of a leading private sector bank. Prem Raj is the co-author of 3 books. All 3 books hit the number one spot on Amazon best-selling list. Views expressed by Prem Raj have been published in Economic Times, Business Standard, Financial Express, Indian Express, Mumbai Mirror, and other periodicals. Prem Raj hails from Mumbai and resides with his wife, son, daughter-in-law, mother-in-law, and pet cat-in-law. I love reading that out, pet cat-in-law. So yes. So welcome, Prem Raj, and over to you. Let's get on with the session that I'm so much waiting for. Over to you.
Thanks, Jaya. Thanks a lot. We have on the show today Ansi. Ansi is a communication skills and soft skills trainer. She has graduated in English literature. She got her CELTA certification from the British Council, Mumbai. For the last 4 years, she has been teaching kids and adults. She's also authored a small pocket book, How to Speak English Like a Pro. This book gives insight into the world of business and formal English. Welcome to the show, Ansi.
Thank you, sir.
So without much ado, let's go to our interactions. And see, we hear the term communication skills and we also hear soft skills. How does one differentiate between these two terms?
Yes. So what do you think are communication skills? Maybe some of you can answer this. You can unmute yourself and answer if you can. What do you think are communication skills? Anybody answering that? Yes.
Either you can unmute yourself or then you can write on the chat.
Yes.
Faster if I unmute. So communication, are you asking me, right? So I will start with my communication coaching. It's more about how we convey a message that we want to the other person, to be very, very specific.
Absolutely. I agree. In today's hectic world, we rely on heavily on sharing information, resulting in the greater emphasis being placed on having good communication skills, if not great communication skills. Good verbal and written communication skills are essential in order to deliver and understand quickly and accurately. Being able to communicate effectively is a vital life skill and should not be overlooked. Nisha, if you can put on the slides, maybe then people can see what it is. Okay, I have a slide for that. And in contrast, poor communication skills can have a negative impact. A poorly delivered message may result in misunderstanding, frustration, and in some cases, disaster. If I can show you, Nisha, can you put on that slide? The presentation, yeah. Go down. Fourth slide. Yes. Can you see this on your screen?
Yeah.
Okay. Now you can see the picture. What does it tell you? It tells you communication skills forms a very small part, whereas soft skills forms the larger picture. Okay. Now, soft skills is more about people skills, how one handles people and their social interactions and relationships. Communication skills is more about how one can convey their thoughts and feelings, just like Jaya told. It is a tool that relies on verbal sounds and language construction so that people can talk to each other effectively. A person with good communication skills means that he or she knows how to be accurate in terms of understanding the other person and also making sure that the other party understood the content clearly. Usually, a person having poor communication skills is also because he or she has poor soft skills. What do you say? Is it right or wrong?
Yes.
Do you think that is the case? Yes. It will never be the case where someone with good communication skills will have poor soft skills, or someone with good soft skills will have bad communication skills. It is when a person knows how to interact effectively with people, he or she knows exactly what to say to better the communication and the conversation and the relationship.
How was it?
We need to have soft skills first, then we make use of good communication skills as a tool to present our soft skills. Having good interaction with people also includes knowing when to be quiet, listen when necessary, or when to stop probing when the other party is getting uncomfortable. You might have seen in parties and things like that when people just rant off, even if you are wanting to try to escape from there. Have you noticed that?
Yes. Very much.
There's a lot of body language that has to be noticed when you're doing soft skills. Such knowledge about people allows a person with good soft skills to make use of communication skills to diverge the topic so that the person will feel comfortable around him or her.
Okay, thanks for bringing this out. Yes, communication skills and soft skills, though they are complementary, there is a subtle difference which we need to know if we have to really progress in life. Thanks for bringing it out, Nancy.
Thank you.
Is there some way a person can speak correctly in a relaxed manner, or does one have to learn through a converted methodology?
This question is interesting, and it brings us to a question itself. talking about methodology, which is which in language is its grammar. So are we going to look at grammar? No, we are looking at grammar, yes, but grammar is necessary for the construction of the sentence, the correct construction. So I will only touch on one small part of grammar, which is called the subject-verb agreement. Many of us have been through this in school, and it has been drilled into us from that famous red book which we used to have, the Ren and Martin.
Ren and Martin, I still have it.
Yes, actually it's outdated right now. No doubt other things have come in. But yes, vouch by the Ren and Martin. Yes. But have we really understood the meaning of it? Many of us haven't. We just speak up. In academic writing, grammar and sentence structure are of paramount importance. While this is also true for informal pieces of writing, grammar mistakes in academic writing can instantly reduce the credibility of the author. Therefore, it is important to ensure that the subject and the verb always agree with each other. Okay, the relationship between the subject and the verb lies at the very heart of a grammatically correct English sentence. It makes the sentence easier to understand. For example, if I mention some sentences, Nisha, if you could play that on the screen. George, play. Nisha?
The video or...
No, the presentation only. I'll tell you when the video comes. Go down. Yeah, the George play. Is this sentence correct? It's the second sentence. She brush her hair. Is this correct? Or even the next one, Christina renew her license. Or else the other one, they eat apples. Well, if you come to see it, this conveys the message, no doubt. But let's correct these sentences. Nisha, George plays. She brushes her hair. Christina renews her license. They eat apples. Now, if I mention that when the subject is singular, the verb is plural. Go back to the other one. And when the subject is plural, the verb is singular. Like in the case of George plays, George is the subject, is singular, so the verb becomes plural and hence it becomes plays. Like in the, similarly in the fourth sentence, number four, where the sentence they is plural, so the verb changes and becomes singular form of eat, not eats. So in each of these sentences, it is clear to the reader who performed the action. It is also clear what they did. The agreement here is now crystal clear, and we aren't left wondering who did what and who did not do what. So it is safe to say that this forms a critical part of spoken English too. So I have this for subject verb agreement. It's very important. Quite a few people make mistakes in speaking this. That's why I brought this topic up.
Good. That was quite enlightening. Are there any common mistakes that people have to look out for apart from the ones that you showed now, those four?
Yes. I bring you to the second most common mistake people often make. Which verb follows the word did or didn't? The verb do is quite a unique verb in the sense that it can be joined by the present tense of the verb. I am using technical jargon, but don't worry, when the examples come, you will know what I'm talking about. Okay?
Yeah.
Have you heard of the sentence, I not like him? You might have heard it many times. However, grammatically, this sentence is wrong. Unless you are a prehistoric caveman uttering broken English.
Did the caveman speak English?
Sorry?
Did the caveman speak English?
I hope not. I wonder what did they do. Okay. The correct sentence was, I do not like him. Not I like, I not like him. Okay? This sounds more appropriate, or at least more grammatically appropriate. Well, the rule is too easy, my friend. If you use did or didn't, you always follow it with the verb in the simple present tense. For example, I did eat. So did is the past tense and eat is the present tense. You won't say I did eat. Or I didn't eat. Okay, if you say I didn't eat, it will be wrong because there'll be two past tense in the same sentence. Okay, that is a wrong according to grammar. When there is already one past tense, we will go for eat as a present tense. Okay.
Yep.
So examples are, I didn't eat. Didn't they go there last night? I did love him. I did check my email. I didn't buy her flowers. I didn't like the dress. Sorry. He doesn't understand right. I'm so sorry. He doesn't understand right. Okay? And I didn't like the dress. Now, you can see eat, go, love, check, buy, understand, and like are verbs. However, do or didn't were also verbs. Also helping verbs. But since we had do or didn't, we will not be using the same past tense. We will go in for the present tense. That's what.
But thanks for bringing out the subtle differences. It's fascinating. See, at times one hears similar words, and if one runs up the dictionary, there are two or more meanings to certain words. How do we know which one to use?
Yes, sir. This is a wonderful question. I would like to take you into some of the common mistakes we often do while speaking. I have noted that on this platform also, but I had not pointed it out since it becomes very cliche for the English teacher to always point out mistakes. Okay, well, these are called stress words. Let me bring you to stress words. In English language, there are words that we have learned. You might have learned in school, same words having two different meanings. Okay. And they are called homonyms in grammar. Going further deeper into this topic, let me stress on the importance of the word stress on a certain part of the word or the syllable. I'll explain what is a syllable. Okay, Nisha, for instance, Nisha, can you take the slide? Further down. This word, yes, For instance, let's take this word, C-O-N-T-E-N-T. Can any one of you tell me what this is? You can unmute yourself.
Hi, good evening.
Yes, good evening.
My name is Sean. So it can mean two things. Either it can mean content as in some material, as in content of a book.
Okay.
Or it can mean satisfied, as in you're content with what you have.
Okay, that's nice. Very nice, Sean. I like that you came up and said something. Is there anybody else saying something?
Yeah, the content of a content means you are happy.
Okay.
Content.
Yes. Okay, let's see.
That difference in pronunciation makes a world of difference.
Exactly. Thank you so much.
In India, we may not know it, but if you are talking to a foreigner, you know, to a native English speaker, then all these small things start to jar on them.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I totally agree with you. Okay. I would now, this word can be broken into two syllables. Nisha, the next slide. Con and tent. Okay. So syllables means breaking of the word. The action of breaking of the word is syllable. Next slide. If I put the stress on the last syllable, it becomes content. It means to be satisfied or happy. Okay? Can you click on once again? It means to be satisfied or happy. And if I put the stress on the first syllable, the next slide. No, Nisha, then, if I put it on the first syllable, C-O-N-T-E-N-T, can you see the spelling?
Yeah.
Okay, it means subject matter. So content means subject matter and being content means satisfied or happy. Okay, similarly, another word, Nisha. P-R-O-J-E-C-T. Again, Nisha, next slide. We break this into two syllables, project. Now, if I put the stress on the last syllable, project, it means to show. Or, like I can say, I project a slide on the OHP. That's the overhead projector. Okay, Nisha, next slide. And if I put it, it's the first syllable. If I put it on the first syllable, P-R-O-J-E-C-T, that is project, that means a proposal, a school project or a business project. There are words like these, which we can look into when you come to me as for training.
We'll come to that later on.
Yes, yes. Just the gist of this. Yeah, that's it. Okay.
For us, for many of us, English is not the first language. At home and in our surroundings, some other vernacular language might be holding sway. Mm-hmm. How does one from such a background compete with others who have English as their first language?
First, you get a good trainer who can neutralize the accent because most of us have a mother tongue's influence with us. It's called the MTI in jargons in English language teaching. Mother tongue influence has to be removed from the language that we are using. A preferable means, if you are not able to get a good trainer for yourself, is to go through a lot of daily conversation videos which are on YouTube and also listen to speakers and the news and how they are speaking and try to imitate them. That's also a good way.
That will help. Offline, when we were talking about it, you said you might throw a surprise at us.
Yes, I do.
That surprise.
Yes, I have a small little video of 6 minutes 17 seconds, which I really want to show you, and it will show you how a simple sentence changes into a more complex and a more rich sentence. And also it has some tips for business English letter writing. So if you would like to have a look. Nisha, please. Can you play the video?
Yeah.
One second, I am not able to plan. One second.
You can play it from the presentation also. It'll play if it's saved on your if on your laptop. No. Then play it directly.
Actually, the video is open on my screen, but I'm while sharing it, it's not showing that window. One second.
Okay. Yes. There's no volume. Nisha, there's no volume.
Can you hear now?
No. We can't hear. We can only see the video playing. No, Nisha, we can't see. We can't hear anything.
Okay, Nisha, you can keep continuing to try. Nancy, you had mentioned you're conducting some classes or sessions. Can you please tell us about it?
Yes, I can. Well, I am conducting classes. My institute's name is ANS Academy. And we are here to teach you all the aspects of English language. Okay, so it's like an overall development of yourself, of your personality. So I don't deal with the things that the normal English institutes deal with. I would deal with more of spoken English for you. And even we have tailor-made programs that you can deal with. You can take it. I present courses on basic sentence structure formation. And there is a course on vocal projection, wherein, creating that much needed impact on your audience. You might have noticed that I have been using this vocal projection throughout the presentation sometimes. It keeps you enthralled. It keeps you captivated. Then there is, we also do personality development, public speaking. We deal with listening skills, reading skills, writing skills, and speaking skills. Okay. The body language, presentation skills, job interview skills. So this is a course where we do resume building and business English letter writing. Also, we do prepare you for an interview so that you're employable immediately.
Okay.
It's kind of like that. Then another course is a business English. Business English is the words and the terms that you would use in a formal background or in business meetings, how to start a meeting, how to interrupt, how to argue, how to disagree, and all those small little things that is needed where you don't sound rude, but you put your point forward. And in addition to this, we have introduced a new program called mentoring or life mentoring. To explain to this, the subject, it is our target audience would be schools and colleges with the age group of 11 to 21. So that we would want to love to counsel these children on how to face the real world outside. Students in the school are in a kind of a protective shell, teachers loving them, parents saying, oh, that's nice, that's fine, everything is all right. And then suddenly after the 10th, they are pushed into this real world where nothing matters. Your book knowledge doesn't matter. It's all practical. And where honesty was the best policy in school, outside it is not. So to prepare these children, especially when the children get stressed out with this all these things. So just to put them through that counseling, and also we would love to bring in people to talk to them and all those things. So give value to the society as a whole.
That's quite substantial. For this English proficiency that we spoke about, is there any baseline that you need English proficiency for enrolling to your courses?
Actually, no, because I can teach even a vernacular medium student, and I can teach a student who is excellent, who knows his or her English as and when at a different level.
Okay, that's nice. That's nice. Three parting tips for one to improve spoken and written English.
Spoken and written English, maximum try and listen more of English, speak it at home with other people so that even you get a practice, they get a practice, and also try to create an environment where you are constantly bombarded with English.
Okay.
Maybe join a class. Even if you join a class, outside the class, you go and speak in Hindi, it doesn't give you that impact. Again, you have to keep speaking. So practice is the most important thing. Knowing the right thing to practice is most important. And also writing is very important, because when you write, you know what to speak.
True. Thanks for that. Jaya, now I hand over to you. You can read out the chats and take the questions before you finally hand over to me for the closure. Jaya, please.
Shall I play?
All right. My God, that was one grammar session that I attended after long. And I used to also, teach children this, the subject, verb, predicate, and, so many things, the didn't and two past tense not being together, and like beautifully designed, Ansi. Very, very thank happy you. That you have modulated this in such simplicity that anybody who is listening or who is looking through this, will get so much value. And I'm very happy that we have done this on Power Up. Now, meanwhile that people get ready with their questions, let me read out what we have in our comments right here.
Jaya, 1 minute, Jaya. Can Nisha play that video? because that has a lot of information.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
Peace. Yeah, yeah,
so it's
peace.
More of greetings and people saying amazing and all that. So, yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Secrets to Effective Writing and Business Letter Writing. A Crash Course by Anne Lewis. Why do we need to write effectively? We all know how to write, don't we?
Good writing
is supposed to evoke sensation in the reader. Not the fact that it is raining, but the feeling. Let's take a look at a simple sentence. For instance, we stood outside for 20 minutes. To change the sentence, we are going to use the following. An adjective, a time, a place, how or a feeling, a reason. So let's begin with adding an adjective here to the otherwise simple sentence to create a little drama. We stood outside for 20 miserable minutes. Here, with adding an adjective miserable, we have changed the feeling of the sentence. Furthermore, let's add a time to this newly formed sentence. This morning, we stood outside for 20 miserable minutes. Moving on, let's add a place instead of the usual outside. This morning, we stood on the sidewalk of school for 20 miserable minutes. In addition to this, let's add how to the sentence. This morning, we stood shivering on the sidewalk in front of the school for 20 miserable minutes. Finally, adding a reason to this. This morning, we stood shivering on the sidewalk in front of the school for 20 miserable minutes while the fire chief investigated the cause of the fire alarm. So you see, we have changed the sentence from we stood outside for 20 minutes to this morning we stood shivering on the sidewalk in front of the school for 20 miserable minutes while the fire chief investigated the cause of the fire alarm. And voila, you've got something outstanding. How to write an effective business letter. To introduce to you this topic on why do we need to write business letters, we write business letters for the following: to persuade, to inform, to request, to express thanks, to remind, to formalize decisions, to recommend, to apologize, to congratulate, to reject a proposal or an offer, to follow up, to introduce a person or a policy. A business letter is made up of three paragraphs, wherein the first paragraph will be your introduction, the second paragraph will be the reason, the third will be the thanks and acknowledgement. Your address and the receiver's address will form the beginning of your letter. The date is very important. Salutations like dear sir, dear madam. Subject has to be underlined. Your introduction, reason or request, thanks and acknowledgement, and the closing salutation. Here are some useful phrases for the opening of your letter. I, your name, refer to your letter dated. I am writing to complain. I am writing to inform you. I wish to draw your attention. I wish to inform you. Some useful phrases for closures. I look forward to hearing from you. I would be grateful if you look into the matter. Please contact me if you require any details. Please do not hesitate to contact me should you require any further information. I trust that you will give this matter your urgent attention. Finally, add in your closing salutation. If you know the person's name, use yours sincerely. If you don't know the person's name, use yours faithfully or yours truly. Do not forget to sign your name and give your contact details in the end. Thank you.
Wow, that was beautifully compiled.
Thank you.
That was so amazing. It's like a mini workshop, Ansi. This is like amazing. In a very small span of time, you have given a lot of value. So if somebody is following through on this video, they understand business writing as well as sometimes even emails need this kind of language. So thank you so much for that. I always wanted actually that something similar we should do on Power Up. So I'm really happy that this happened.
Thank you. And I am willing to give this video free if anybody wants to see it again. I'm willing to give it free.
That is so kind of. So this will get recorded in any case and we'll put it forward there. But we can do a proper workshop also in future if that need be, because there are a lot of people who need this kind of information, Ansi, because people lose their confidence when they are not very good with any particular language. So if I'm using Hindi and I'm not comfortable with Hindi, it will make me nervous. If I'm using English and if I'm not comfortable with English, I will be nervous. So you chose that need to learn English is something, and I highly recommend Ansi. I mean,
thank you. I'm humbled.
The best I have seen so far, and she brings so much value to Power Up. There is no question about it.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. This framework that whatever you have mentioned is applicable for writing business letter, irrespective of the language. It could be
absolutely
template is there. So
yeah,
that is wonderful of you. Nice, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Means a lot. Deepak ji is raising his hand. Yes, Deepak ji.
There is this one question which I have always wanted to ask and I have never got a reply to this. And see, yes. Why the hell does psychology start with a P?
I have other words also.
PO2 hai, but GO goo nahi hai. That is the answer.
Actually, it is to balance the amount of letters in the word, I guess. That's what the explanation I read. Why some words are silent in an English language.
Yeah. One was that, and the other part where you said, most of us have a typical accent depending upon our mother tongue, you know.
Yes.
If I am Sindhi, I typically talk in English, which is Sindhi-ish. Somebody
exactly.
Who is Tamil or Telugu talks in English. Clearly, there is that South Indian accent which we call that.
True.
If somebody is Maharashtra and Gujarati, clearly there is that accent. And you said that, by practicing or doing some sort of a training or a workshop, I'm sure you can't get rid of the accent totally, but you can make it better.
Yes.
My point is this. When you are trying to do this, aren't you trying to be who you are not? Or there are times when somebody who is speaking in a language which is not native to him or her it feels artificial. You know, it's like, you know, they're trying to play or trying to make up. What would you like to say on that?
Again, I would come back to accent neutralization is what I'm looking for, not adding an accent. So when you are adding an accent, you sound artificial. Especially when we go for American accents, British accents, yeah. Australian, yeah. We sound artificial. But we as Indians have a very neutral accent if coming to English. That is something that we should be proud of, actually. Yeah. And if we go to America or if we go to England, we can pick up their accent easily.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to be so difficult.
Yeah. In fact, I totally resonate with you. Recently, sometime back before lockdown, I was there in the US and we were traveling. And I clearly found that our English, you know, our Indian English, since there is no real accent, we are neutral. Whoever you communicated with, they understood us very clearly. Whereas there were these Chinese and then there were these other people who were trying to speak in English. But those Americans, those guys sitting on the other side of the counter were finding it difficult to understand what these guys are saying. Our English is really clearly, very, very simple to understand. Yeah.
True. And, fortunately, we were trained by the British.
Yeah.
Yes. and we follow the syllable to syllable. We don't like try to add our own new versions of the syllable. Yes. That's why it's so simple. Yeah.
I was in Bali for a course. I was doing a course in Bali wherein I was the only Indian there and all the others were Australians. So after my presentation, the thing that they said was, we had no difficulty understanding what you spoke. You had a very neutral accent and we had no difficulty in understanding it. And like Deepak said, they mentioned that there are other nationalities where they found it very, very difficult to understand many of the words. So we should be proud about our Indian background and that neutral accent.
Yes.
Exactly. And it won't be difficult for us to pick up a new language because at least the average Indian knows at least 5 languages.
Yes.
So English would be just an added one.
That's true. And that's amazing. Yeah. Really. And see, you are really too good. The other day when you hosted the show, you were a superstar then and you're a superstar today for bringing so much value. This is something which is very, very beneficial for everybody and I'm sure everyone will agree to this. So let's hear some praises right there. Mr. Jagannath Rao says, business letter writing in less than 10 minutes. Oh, yeah. Yatin Parekh. So Yatin Bhai is our new member. He is also saying thank you.
Yes.
Savio Varid says, great initiative by Power Up Jaya Premraj sir. Kudos to all of you. Yes, Savio, to all of us, you must say.
Yeah. It's a joint effort combined.
Yes. So Arvind Badivadekar says, effective tips, ANSI. So yes, ANSI, these are really helpful. I think Mr. Jagannath is wanting to say something.
Yes, sir.
It is in continuation of to what Premraj sir said. I spent quite a number of years, more than 2 decades in R&D institutions, wherein scientists would come from different parts of the world. Uh-huh. And the presentation of their scientific material, unfortunately for them, was in English. And sitting in the audience, literally, I break my head to figure out what he's telling. Such a difficulty. What Premraj said, when he was appreciated for his expression was very clear, they could understand very easily.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to share that with the community here.
Absolutely.
And we have that language. And also, as you said, we have minimum 3 language formula is there for us.
Yes,
that's true.
You are forced to you are having 3 language formula, and if your mother tongue is something, you become 4 language by expert, and if that's you have interest, 5, 6, 7, it goes on like that.
Exactly. There is no limit, and age has no limit, so then we can learn more.
We can learn more, and we have more adaptability is also there.
Yes, absolutely.
See, if you know Tamil, you can survive in Tamil Nadu and Hindi. You can survive, get adjusted in very easily.
True. I am a Malayali.
Help people to connect.
I am a Malayali myself, but I don't have the mother tongue influence on my English. So that's neutral.
And helps, language helps people to connect.
Yeah. Yes, absolutely.
Sebastian is giving some really good comments there, amazing and all that. And in the end, he said a very nice thing. He says, and see, your smile itself is an added language.
Yeah. Thank you, Sabi.
That's a universal language, yeah.
It lights up the room.
Yes.
So, yes, Deepakji, you wanted to say something.
Yeah, I wanted to share something which happened quite a few years ago. I remember my daughter was 2 years old and we had sent her to a nursery. And this was like, you know, the number one nursery to be in our area. If you were somebody, you wanted your child to go to this nursery, right? And I met the principal. She was like known to me. And I spoke to her and I told her, now my daughter has just started learning. You know, she started talking and she's coming to your nursery. Do you recommend that we speak to her in English at home? She said, no. At home, you speak to her in your mother tongue. That is where she will learn. Let her learn English at our school. You speak to her at home in your mother tongue. That way she gets a chance to learn her mother tongue also, and then we teach her the English. If you talk to her in English when she is 2 years old and if she learns English at school, she will end up learning only one language, English. So I remembered this and I tell everybody, you know, most of our communities are somehow losing our language. Our children, the way they are being brought up, you know, they either can't read our script or they can, if they can only talk about it. You know, I can speak for myself. We are Sindhis. I find it very difficult to read my script because everybody wants you to be speaking in a language that everybody can understand. At home, we converse amongst ourselves in our local language, in our mother tongue. So this is a good tip which our principal of that school gave us, that when your child is growing up, you see to it that you converse with them in your mother tongue.
That's absolutely true.
Thanks for sharing.
That's absolutely true, sir.
And there is another psychological reason behind why an educator would have said this. Because when a child is growing up, the language that he's hearing at home, because either you all speak English, then that's the language of the home. But if you're only speaking that with the child and others are speaking a different language within themselves, psychologically, it doesn't sharpen the mind as much as it does when he's listening to the language with all, which all are speaking. That is the psychological part of it. So, yeah, just wanted to add.
Plus one more thing. A child, if you note, can speak to each person in the house in the language that they are comfortable in.
Yeah,
children are very, very smart. Very smart.
Yeah, they speak to the servants in one way and to the parents in another way and to an ambassador in another way.
Absolutely.
Diplomats too.
Yes.
Diplomats. Actually, it was very helpful. And see, I'm also teaching English to students who have had exposure to the language, but even now they can't write a sentence properly in English. If I give them a test in grammar, they score very good marks. But when it comes to speaking, especially Malayalis, I find them so inhibited about talking. Very difficult for me to get them to break out their barrier and talk, you know, open your mouth.
I know it is difficult because they're not used to it.
No, they want to be perfect before they talk. And unless they talk, they'll never be perfect. So it's a kind of a vicious.
That's true. That is what we have to explain it to them.
Yeah.
I have a question.
Tell me.
Can I?
Yes. Please.
In a language is picked up by growing child, which is growing. Growing child picks up languages just like that, very easily. Yeah. As we grow, we find it very difficult. What could be the reason?
Ego.
Ego?
Ego is the problem, yes. Or I know.
The memory slows down?
No, not at all. It actually sharpens. Memory actually sharpens as you grow older also. But the ego comes in the way. I know this much. I can work with this much. Why do I need more? It's like that काम चल जाता है ना तो बस है.
Okay, we'll manage with whatever we know.
Exactly. But the problem comes when you have to go and do business outside India. Yes. That is when you require them.
Thank you.
Yes, Reina says with children also it is fear.
Yeah, and because other people make fun of them.
Yes.
So they're always looking down and they feel that maybe mommy, papa or the people are always people who are ridiculing me. And if you don't trust them, if you don't believe in them, and if you are not able to enable them to probably use the right language, because I see today a lot of teachers, including my child's teacher. So she keeps telling, these are banished, boring words. And she gives them like 100 words. And then she says, this is thesaurus, and this is dictionary, and this is this word and that word. And I'm like, oh my God, so where does this poor child go to? Of course, we got these books, but we got it at different age groups. We got one at 4th standard, we got one at 6th standard, we got one at 10th standard. And finally, after we finished school, then we got to know of GRE and TOEFL books, which I studied and passed out for doing my foreign exams. But these are at different ages and different levels. But nowadays, teachers are so competitive because study has become so competitive that the poor child doesn't know where do I pick the words, and finally doesn't want to pick any of them. And he says, Mama, I'm okay to what I know is good enough. And with this, I'm going to do my comprehension. And then he gets poor marks. And then we have to sit and imbibe. Please study only 5 words. Pick it from the newspaper. Read the newspaper. Where you find difficult words, come back to me and Papa and then ask us. And then start imbibing in your language usage. So without even knowledge of his words, sometimes he uses funny words in between funny sentences. And the explanation of it is not right. But then when we explain it back to him, then it sits on his head that, you know, the meaning of it is this. But yes. I would really, really say this because I find, especially now when my child is having an exam, and he just finished an English paper yesterday. Oh my God, I was having hell a lot of time to teach that comprehension part where I was trying to tell him, it's okay, beta, write what you know. There's no problem for getting less marks, but go and write confidently what you know. I'm okay with any marks. I don't have any categories of 70%, 80%, 90% or 100% because even being a gold medalist, I don't think we've done much with regard to knowledge, but all what we have today is what we carry out. So
that's
I don't want to stress him, but if there is something which we can do easier there, Ansi, you can share, because that's one level which kids find it stressful. And I find it very nice when every day you send out that one word in the group and, you know, I'm learning a new word every day. So
thank
I really
you so
love
much.
That word of yours, which comes every day as a learning for me as well.
Thank you. But this is another, now we have to push the government of India to bring in CELTA teachers, that is CELTA, CELTA teachers to teach English, especially in schools. That will change the level of English that we are having in schools. B.Ed is outdated, sorry to say that, but the level, the benchmark that we have set in CELTA is different than B.Ed. B.Ed is more commercial now, and CELTA actually deals with more of student interaction than teacher. So the students are learning more.
CELTA indeed is a very good course. I had also planned doing it once upon a time, but now I'm happy I have somebody who's done it. So, you know, whatever it is that I aspired is going to be done through ANSI now.
Yeah.
I always tell my students.
She saved me the time.
Yeah. I just like to add to what Raina said just now. You know, I'm totally in agreement with her. She has a 12-year-old son. I have a 12-year-old son. So when you are in a lot of panels like these, you know, you hear that our education system needs to change. We were taught this way. Now studies are this way. But I would actually like to say something else. Most of us came out from an education system which we finally end up criticizing, saying it needs to change. It turned out pretty well. Actually, our education system was very good, which has brought us over here.
Yes.
So
actually,
nothing wrong. Yeah. Yeah, yes. Actually turned out very well, right?
Mythology was also very good, Deepakji. Now though kids don't know even Ram and Ravan, they feel both are same.
Precisely, that is exactly what I am saying. I am in total agreement with you. Our syllabus, our Bal Bharati books, when we were studying, were actually better books for a child to grow up on rather than what is being given to them now. Our education system, our syllabus was taught to us, which it was much better. Today's children do not, you know, even at 7th, 8th standard, sometimes what I wonder that what I knew in that age at 7th standard, and a child today who is exposed to the internet with Google, they're having every answer. Most of these children know nothing, not even 10% of what we knew when we were at that.
Yeah, I completely agree, and thank you for the insights. We have run out of time. It's past 8. So I think we will wind up here. Anybody has any questions for Ansi, can send them to me or Prem Raj, and we can take it with her offline to respect everybody's time. And we will meet again tomorrow, same time, same time, of course, not same day, with yet another speaker with Prem Raj. So before we wind up, anybody who's looking at joining Power Up, please connect with us and we will let you know whatever are the details and the joining procedures. I will put over to you, Prem Raj sir, so that we wind up and we close for the day. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ansi, for an enlightening session. We now have clarity on the nuances of the English language. In future, we will be mindful on the appropriate usage of words. Thank you for enriching our language skills. Thank you and good night.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Good night and bye-bye. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye. Bye.